God. I told the team in the pre-service that I was so excited about the message today. It's going to probably be the most pastoral, evangelistic, eldership, anointing, loving, caring messages that I have ever brought forth. Why all the murmuring in the house? I mean to tell you, it's a great day. Everybody say a great day. All right, how many brought a Bible? I like the sound of that. Amen. Say, I am. Everything this Bible says I am. I have everything this Bible says I have. In fact, today, I'm going to do what my Bible says. I don't care what anybody else thinks about it. It's my decision. Amen. Amen. All right, I want you to go to Genesis. And then I also want you to turn to the last scripture that I'm going to give you today, which is 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. We know the beginning from the end, or the end from the beginning. God is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. If we know where we're going, then we've got a good idea of where we need to start from. So I want to take you to the end of the message so you know where we're going. All right? I'm talking today about what about me? Say that real loud. What about me? I'm going to get to that. I'm going to get to that. This message is about you today. What about me? The church world today is always, what about the big name preacher? I'm here to say you're the big name preacher today. Because the song said you're the one that's going into all the world. You're the one that's going to shine the light. So say, Bishop is going to talk about me today. Because he cares about me today. Didn't that sound good? I feel so gooey on the inside about it. You know what I mean? 2 Peter 1:10. This is where we're going to end up. Everybody say this is where we're going to end up today. Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. Your calling. Say, my calling. My calling. You have a call. I'm just telling you, you have a call today. Ring, ring. Say, I didn't know I was called. Well, ring, ring. Hello? So, you've been called. Many are called. Now, few are chosen. But there is a call. So, it says, make sure that you know what your calling is. Are you ready? If you make sure you're calling an election, if you do these things, if you do your call, you will never fall. All right, let me try this. Well, you know, if I pray and fast for 13 hours a week, if I go hungry, do a 40-day fast every 3 years, if I... No, it doesn't say that. What it says here is if you will do your call, you'll never fall. Wow. Yeah. Amen. Now, let me tell you a few things it doesn't say. If you do Bishop's call, you will fall. Yeah. If you try to do something you're not called to do, you will immediately fall. The world always wants to do what somebody else is doing. Yeah. And God wants to tell you today, no, the way you'll never fall is do what you're called to do. Mm-hmm. Look around and say, whoa, that looks a little scary. Now, look at this next thing. This next verse is amazing. How many already? All right, I don't want to go too fast. What are we here today for? It's about you. It's about me. I have to know what my call is. And if I do my call, I will never fall. Does this sound like a message you want to hear?
Yes.
Now let's go to the next verse. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Have you ever heard such a powerful verse as that? I mean, hear the romance in it. Hear the power in it. Hear the excitement in it. An entrance. A big door is going to be opened abundantly for you to enter into the kingdom of God and Jesus Christ, the everlasting kingdom. This is not a gospel about tomorrow if you've got a house or a car and you can make the payments. This is a gospel about everlasting. This is a gospel about 1,000 years from now. Today and 1,000 years from now. How many wants to walk through that door? So we back up and say, well, then I have to know what I'm called to do. I just have to know what I'm called to do, and then what? Do it. You say, well, I think that's back to sounding kind of hard now. No, let's just go back to the beginning. Everybody say, now the beginning. In the beginning, Genesis 1:1, how many has heard of that far back? In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. How many's got that down? Genesis 1:20 through 25, God created the fish of the sea, created the fowls of the air, created the animals of the field. Are you okay? The Bible says the heavens declare and express His glory. So let me ask you, why did God create the heaven and the earth? To express His glory. He created different kinds of fish, same mindset, to express His glory. A lot of people's got this picture of God who's just this old man sitting on a stone throne. So God has to obliterate that mindset and say, no, this is who I am, the sun, moon, and the stars, and the universe, and the solar system. Whoa. He says, well, really, what I am is trees. Pine tree. Fruit tree, oak tree, beautiful leaves and colors, olive tree, oil. Well, which one are you? Yes. So you think you know God, eh? Now, He is trying to express Himself. He's trying to show Himself to the world. Are you okay? And then He went way past logical thinking. Genesis 1:27. So God created man in His own imagination. In the imagination of God, He created male and female. Well, if you follow the pattern, why did He do that? To express His glory. He imagined, let me see, I'm going to scrape up some dirt and I'm going to express myself through that dirt. Are you okay? Let's catch the picture now. Why do we get a reverse on that and say, God, I really want to do this for You? The tree wasn't doing anything for God. God was doing something through the tree. The animal wasn't doing anything for God. God was expressing Himself through the animal. Stop trying to do something for God. I know that'll rattle your brain for a moment. But stop trying to do something for God. What in the world do you think a pile of dirt is going to do that's going to impress God anyway? I mean, just think about it for a moment. There's going to be a bunch of piles of dirt that's going to say, but Lord, Lord, I did many wonderful works in your name. He's going to say, what? No, no, the purpose and your call was for me to express me through you. Takes the pressure off you. We'll get back to that song, We Shine. Well, you can't shine unless something brighter is coming on you and you're reflecting it. When God made the sun and the moon does not have any light of itself. All it does is reflect the sunlight. This is like who we are. We just reflect His light. We express His light. How many wants just to express God to the world? Now, just like there are different trees. It's like there's different stars. There's the sun, there's the moon, there's the stars, there's the constellations. They're all different, but they all tell the story of God. The trees all tell the story of God. Romans, Paul's writing to the Romans and saying, you can't deny God, just look up. I'm sorry, well, we never heard the gospel. Excuse me, go outside at night and look up. Definitely there was a big bang and somebody lit the match. There is a God. There is a creator. Amen? Amen. And now we look at people. Everybody say people. Whew. Can you find anybody alike? I mean, really? Why? Because God imagined it that way. He did not imagine an assembly line that every person comes out the same. He wanted to express the vastness of His nature. And so He imagined, I'm going to create a woman like that. I'm going to create a man like that. I'm going to create a woman like that. I'm going to create a man like that. Why? Because each one is going to express God to the world the only way that can be done. I cannot express God the way that Minister Riley can. I cannot express God the way Deacon Heath can. I can't express God the way... Yeah, I was thinking of coming over and dancing alongside Amanda this morning, you know? There was a moment where we all could have come forward. I just want to let you know for future reference. Do you know sometimes when the world goes to concerts, they all come to the stage and they're all dancing. I felt for a moment that's what was supposed to happen this morning. So just, yeah, and the cameraman was boogieing. The white-haired cameraman was boogieing behind the camera this morning. So just so you know, in future reference, we have to move with what God wanted to express the dance today. Now, it was happening out there, but how cool would it have been if we would have all been doing the rave? Is that what they call it up here, you know, or something? Sorry, I don't know. Not a good illustration. I'm a little too old for these young terms. See, she, my wife is even now too old to even know what that is. Hallelujah. Sorry. Just leave it alone. Leave it alone. Move on. Aaron, you will now be doing much editing on this message, I can see now. Oh, God, Bishop Dad really messed up there, you know. But he's just expressing God in his way. I got to get at this message a little more farther here. Here it is. God created all of you in His imagination. He imagined you, Stephanie. And He said, okay, I'm going to make you just like that. Are you with me? He made Nate Evans. He imagined Nate Evans, analytical. Analyze something to absolute death. Calculate everything out. Wait until the last moment and blow past it because I don't know if I've got all the facts. And then he imagined Amanda Evans. And he imagined putting them together. And he chuckles. Because Amanda Evans is dancing, bouncing off walls, spontaneous, absolutely appalled that you have to think about anything for more than 5 minutes. And then he puts you two together and says, "This is good. This is going to be good. This is going to be good." Amen. The Bible's, you know, I don't know about the Bible, but opposites attract. I mean, he knows that. Opposites attract. And there was a play or a movie, or not a movie, but a play, a drama or whatever. And it was like, "Hi, I love you. You know, we just got married. I love you. You're perfect. Now change." Okay, so opposites attract, and we're so excited about that, and then we spend the rest of our life trying to change that person into who we are. Hello. Here's kind of where I'm going. We get born again, and then we think we have to change. Now, God started revealing this to me slowly, because he knew I needed it slowly, because I do have a little Nate Evans characteristics in me also. I've got a little bit of both. I'll jump out of the boat, but I want to calculate if I need a life raft or not. And just, I like jumping out of the boat, but I'm thinking, okay, I'm probably going to get wet, so I just want to be prepared, you know? I don't mind. I'm not staying in the boat, Amanda. You understand? I'm not staying in the boat. I can't do that. I got to get out, but, you know, I just want to be prepared. So, you know, I told Elder Christy, count to 10. Just count to 10. That's all. Just count to 10. It's enough time for God to say, "Not yet." That's all. God gave me this phrase, "I don't expect anybody to change." And so I meditated on that for a while, and I thought, you know, I get it, because I'm getting to the point where I don't expect anybody to change. And then I realized, Bill, you don't even expect yourself to change. How many kind of started hearing that when I started saying that? Yeah, I don't expect you to change. Because, my God, that's who you are. I don't expect me to change. And I realized, unless God put his finger on your heart, nothing was ever going to be different. How many understood that? And then you watch God touch you, and you're still the same way that you were before. But there is a major difference. Let's look at a few things here. God took his imagination and created every one of you the way you are. First of all, don't get mad at him for doing that. He put everybody in his body as it has pleased him. Then he said he blessed them, and he said, "Be fruitful, make more of you." Okay, I don't know how many Amandas we can handle. I don't know how many Nates we can handle. You know what I'm saying? Now think about it. Do you think the world should be filled with people like you? You've been trying to change the world to be like you. But if you think about it, my God, God help the world if everybody was like me. I mean, I would kill everybody if there weren't a pastor to come along and mop up the blood, you know? But without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin, you know? What about me? Well, God created you in his imagination. God imagined what you would be like. God imagined himself displaying his glory through you. So I'm trying to get to it. God wants to display his glory, his nature, breakthrough in Amanda. He's a dancer. He's a praiser. He's a bounce off the wall kind of God. He's an out of the box God. And yet, God has to use a Nate to explain. He's got this thing so calculated, the planets are right on time for 7,000 years. They're not bouncing into each other. They're still moving like clockwork. The sun still shines. Moon still shines. Are you with me? So if we don't have a calculated person, analytical person, we'll never understand that side of God. You can't have a chaotic God. God came in and brought order. So there's some order that has to happen, and yet he's not so orderly that you can't enjoy life. He came to give you life and give it to you more abundantly. You okay? So this is what happens to people. Well, I'm different. I'm peculiar. How many would all say you're different and peculiar? Say, I qualify for peculiar. Well, I don't seem to fit. Here's what probably everybody says. I don't seem to fit. Well, it's what you're trying to fit into. So you're trying to fit into something that's not your call. You would fit perfectly in your call. Well, I'm passionate about something that somebody's not passionate about. Well, God intended that. I love to do, fill in the blank. Well, some people don't love to do what you do. So stop trying to get everybody to do what you do because you love to do it. Because they don't love to do that. Because you haven't stopped long enough to know what they love to do. And why is what you love to do more important than what they love to do? Am I preaching okay today? I can't help but to. Now think about that. Because who you are, you can't help but do that. I talk. I can't help that. When I try to be quiet, my mouth still runs. Until finally I see my wife just get a hazy look over her eyes, and I know, okay, I probably overdid it. You're not listening anymore. I get that. I can't help but. But then on the flip side, somebody else, I can't help but not pay attention. I can't help but pay attention for about 30 seconds, and I'm gone. How many, are you getting this? All right. I get bored easily. I get bored easily. How many would say, yeah, I get bored easily? But some people will say, I love being bored. I mean, you must love being boring because, my God, you are boring. Apparently you enjoy being boring. I'm committed. I'm committed. And then the other person says, I have a tough time being committed. I mean, committed is like, I hate being tied down. God created you, who you are, and the way that you are. We have to start with that. God's purpose is for his glory to be fruitful and multiply in the way you are. He wants more analytical, calculated, committed, dedicated, want to make sure the job is done perfectly and correctly and with preciseness. But then he also wants people to be spontaneous and inspirational and exciting. But he also wants people to mop up the floor after those two people go through. He needs all of this working together to express himself. Here's the problem. The problem is Satan picks up on this and says, this looks like a tremendous opportunity for what I want done to be fruitful and multiply. So now what I'm going to do is, I already know this excited person. I'm going to put my thoughts and imaginations into that personality, and they're going to go bounce off walls for me. Or I'm going to put this calculated thought into some false religion, and they're going to calculate that out, and they're going to multiply that. Make any sense to you? I'm going to take a non-committed type person, don't want to be tied down, and I'm going to put them in the church to split churches. I'm going to take my tree of the knowledge of good and evil and put that in each one of these unique human beings so that I can be fruitful and multiply. When you get born again, you don't change who you are. You change the message and purpose that you're carrying. Now, I was a leader in the world. That's just who I was. I was the leader in the world. People were always following me. I was leading them the wrong way. But I was the leader in the world. When I got born again, God didn't change me from being a leader to a follower. He just changed where I was going and where I was leading people. Making sense to you? I mean, I was a musician before I got saved. After I got saved, well, then I just had a band for the Lord. He didn't take all my musical ability away from me. I was president of future teachers in school. When I got born again, he didn't take my knowledge and understanding away. He just gave me knowledge about something else. And so I've been a teacher in the body of Christ. He didn't change who I was. He changed my message that I was carrying and my purpose in life. Am I making any sense to you? Now, where do we start? Make your calling and election sure. See, when you do this church thing, it's not about you changing who you are. It's just changing the message you're carrying. Are we doing okay? All right, now. What's in a name? What's in a name? Remember the teaching on words are spirit? Words create? All right, let's follow this through. God created everything with His Word. His Word is the alphabet, the Hebrew language. Let me give you just a little bit of that. In the English, means nothing, all right? Hebrew, every letter has a number, every letter has a picture, every letter has a story and a meaning. Yeah. So when God spoke this God language, it not only gave a rhythm, a melody, a picture, a purpose. So when He called Adam, Adam became a rhythm. Adam became a purpose. Adam became a destiny. He created him with His what? Word. His alphabet. Are you okay with that? It's another whole teaching, but you'll get it. So now He created man in the ability to use words also. So... Adam begins to create. Genesis 2:19, Adam named the animals. God brought the beast to Adam to see what Adam would call them. Everybody say, call them. They didn't become what they were until He called them so. The rabbis teach that God just brought almost like a blob to Adam to see what He would call it. And when He called it that, that's what it turned into. Interesting. If you try to study it out. That's not why I'm here today. He just called him that. Everybody say He called him that. Adam called his wife a woman in the beginning. After she ate of the tree, he called her Eve. Name change. the man with the womb, and now she became the mother of all living, and in pain and in childbirth. As long as she was the man with the womb, everything was good. When she turned into a different message, pain involved. Name change. Now, parents, are you ready for this? They have been given the privilege of God to name their children. Yeah. To call their children. Words create. Yeah. All right, let me go through this. How many has heard of Jehovah? See, again, it means behold the hand, behold the nail. The picture of a hand, the picture of a nail. The name itself is not only a picture, it has a numeric value, etc. Yes? So Jehovah is not just, you know, the name of God. No, it's the purpose of God. It's the nature of God. It's the glory of God. Are you following this so far? All right. Felt like I was losing you a little bit. Jehovah Jireh. I may have heard of that. Of course, you know, J's, everybody uses it. There's no J in the Hebrew language. So when we say Jehovah Jireh, we're really gringos. Just saying. A Hebrew person will say gringo, Greek. But it's a famous one, Jehovah Jireh, which means what? My provider. Why do we just say my provider? Why don't we say behold the hand, behold the nail who provides for me? Because that's what it means. You don't get the provider without the hand and the nail. All right, Jehovah Shalom, my peace. Well, you don't get peace without the hand and without the nail. Jehovah Rophi, my shepherd. Well, you don't get the shepherd without the hand and the nail. Jehovah Nisi, his banner over me is love. Well, you don't understand love until you behold the hand and behold the nail. Do you understand how powerful names are? This is the name of God. Why does he have all these different names? Because that's how we relate to him. Yeah. Are you with me? So we look at, I'm picking on Amanda and Nate today. Is it okay? You are going worldwide today. You're going into all the world and preaching the gospel through analytical and bouncing off the wall. The name expresses something. Are you with me? So if God wants to express, I'm your provider, he's going to use that name. People know him by that name. Well, I need peace. Well, you're going to go to where the peace is. So if I need excitement, probably Nate's not the guy I'm going to hang around with. Are you with me? But if I want to sit down and have an intelligent conversation, I'm probably not going to do it with Amanda. Because we'll be off into acting and fantasy land and bouncing off the wall and excitement and a story and... Are you with me? But we're not going to get too much drama out of Nate. What do you need? Are you with me? See, if you want a psalmist anointing, I'm not it. At least tone-wise. I can help you with words, but the tone's a little bit... Tone would not be my calling. Make my calling and election sure that I do not drive people away from God. Listen to this one, Yeshua. How many wants to know what that means? Yeshua, Savior, Deliverer, Responsible, Domineering, Called to Assist Others. That's Yeshua. Are you ready for this? I looked up Jesus. Pleasant, diplomatic, public relations, likes finer things in life, procrastinate. For those that appreciate the analytical side there, for those that say, I don't care, you know, I'll move right along. I wonder how many is calling on Jesus and not calling on Yeshua. They're calling on a public relations man instead of a savior and a deliverer. They're calling on the Jesus, help me, bless me, finer things in life instead of the one that is domineering and Lord. Names. Everybody say names. The words you name, or the words, your name and its meaning has been spoken over you all your life. Hannah, 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 Hannah. It's not just the name that you respond to. It has purpose. It has meaning. It is who you are. It's what you're being called. And we don't understand these things. Name change. Saul. How many has heard of Saul? This is what Saul means. Shrewd, leader, business, finance. He was just a businessman, a Pharisee. He was a businessman, had a nice business going, would have never left that. He would have been shrewd in that. But God had to change his name to Paul. Knock him off his horse and change his name to Paul. Are you ready for what Paul means? Desire for change and new experience. Impulsive. Let me give you another one. Abram. Expressive, diplomatic, and refined. Abraham. Vision, foresight, hold people to responsibility. Father of nations. It's the name that caused the purpose and destiny. Making any sense? Jacob, trickster. He tricked everybody. And the most of his life was being tricked back. Laban tricked him. Give and it will be given. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I told somebody the other day, you know, if Jacob would have just married Leah, he'd have lived happily ever after. But no, he was after Rebekah. That young, cute chickie poo, it could cause you problems, man. Just marry. If you want to be happy for the rest of your life, make an ugly woman your wife. Just say it. No, he wanted Rebecca. And then she ends up dying and he's stuck with Leah and all the concubines. But Jacob got his name changed. Ready for Israel? God changed Jacob to what? Israel. This rule as God. No longer trying to trick his way through life. Now he's going to rule as God. I'll give you just one more. William. Happens to be my name, so I thought I'd use it. William. This is what it means. Individual, reserved, serious, steadfast, not willing to change. But the reserve part is what I underlined, all right? Now, but ever since high school, I went by Bill. I went from William. My grandma called me Little Floydie. Floyd is my middle name. Floyd means depth and breadth of understanding, ability to gather resources and retain them. Floyds are called know-it-alls because, well, they learn and study everything. You know, so I'm born with William and then Floyd and then Anderson also means a few things, too. So anyway, point being, I got to going to school and I was Billy and I just never liked Billy. I thought it sounded a little sissy. OK, I don't know. I'm sorry if your name is Billy. I apologize to you. Billy Graham seemed to do fine with Billy, and I never thought that he was a sissy, but I just didn't like it. So I started just saying my name is Bill. My name is Bill. That's who I am. Bill. I felt Bill was better than Billy. That's just me, okay? Do you understand what I'm saying? Little did I know, this is what Bill means. Pursue undertaking on a grand scale. Visionary, aggressive, and enthusiastic. Here's the point I want to make. There would have never been William Anderson Ministries. course, that means wham, and I don't know what you're going to do with wham. So, I mean, God knew I had to change to Bill. Are you with me? Because William Anderson Ministries would have never went anywhere. It would have just, I would have known it all and happy to keep it to myself. I would have gathered all the information and been fine. I got my just little me four, no more, and we're going to live life, and I could care less what anybody else thinks because I know it all. Wham. I know what that religion believes. I know what that religion believes. I started trying to calculate. I've probably read over 2,000-3,000 books. I mean, there's some books over here. I didn't have any place to store them, so I brought them out here. I mean, these are thick books. Some people pick up one of those books and go, I'm not reading this thing. But I have read all those things. I've read the entire Strong's Concordance. I've read the entire Young's Analytical Concordance. I've read the Vines. I mean, I'm not just, I didn't just look at a few things in it. I mean, I read the thing. You know, books like this. Wham! Floydy. And so I've done that. You know, so when people come to me and say, what do you think about this? I'm able to go into the archives and pull it out. My wife has said, how in the world do you know that? I don't know. I learned it someplace. You know, I grabbed it from someplace, you know? My point is there would have never been a William Anderson Ministries because I needed the visionary on a grand scale. It would have never happened. Now, your married life also, your middle name adds more, which is, I just showed you that, and even your married name. Now, as soon as you get married, now that name, you're starting to be called that. Everybody say called that. I don't know if you're hearing it yet. Make your calling and election sure. Well, I'm waiting to be called. You've been called from your mother's womb. But see, you're waiting for something else other than the thing that you've already been called. Now, there's also nicknames like darling. I looked up darling. It means creative, original, inventive, practical, advice, outspoken, darling. We have pet names, you know, like Shorty. Fatso, Buddy, Muffin, Babe, Firecracker, Meathead. I don't know. There's just a lot of names. Everybody say names. And then there's just name calling. How many's had a few of those names, you know, that now hopefully you don't get called that all the time. All right. But it will have an effect. If a parent says stupid to somebody long enough, they grow up and, you know, I found some people that might just well change their name to stupid because they apparently believe they are certainly acting like it. Not to go on with that. All right. Bishop, tell me what my name means. What about me? What's my name mean? For $50, send your check. And I will give you a complete printout of your first, middle, and last name. Now, there are many different teachings out there about names and personalities, okay? The meaning of names, baby names, but that's pretty shallow. If you do the Google thing and go to the baby names, I mean, who are they? And, you know, I mean, why do they say that name means that? And second of all, it's English. So immediately, there's no picture, no number, no nothing with it. So at least you need to go into the Hebrew aspect to even catch a glimpse of that. Then there's personality profiles, D-I-S-C, domineering, direct, I, inspirational, S, sensitive, C, critical. How many knows there's different personalities? Yeah. And that kind of helps. And then instead of the D-I-S-C, they use the animals. Ugh. Kind of scary. But, you know, you got lion, otter, golden retriever, and beaver. So, yeah, whatever. So, So what, you find out that you're a dog? I don't know if that helps or not, you know, but... five groups of people. That was a great teaching. How many enjoyed that one, you know? And then there's the love languages. There's a book out there called The Love Languages, and you talk love by doing different things, you know? Yeah, I mean, I used to buy her chocolate, and she let me know that she'd rather I take the trash out. So, you know, there's works of service as opposed to gifts, or some people like affirmation, you know, Reverend Connie say, don't tell me you love me, prove it. You know, so, but other people like to hear it. So there's all sorts. How many knows it's just everybody is different. So we try to approach somebody based on us, we're immediately in trouble. So I use all of these things in marriage counseling. I think it's an excellent help, at least to get people to know they're not like you, and you're soon going to find that out. Yeah. All right. And so the world is not going to come together all that easy unless you both get in a gunny sack, we tie the top, and throw you downhill. And when you get down to the bottom, you'll either kill each other or love each other, you know. So, but before you go on a wild goose chase, all right? So what, you know what your name means? Not going to change who you are right now, because you are what you are right now because that name has been spoken over you. All right. So like I'm saying, I was a leader before I got saved. I didn't become a leader because I found out my name meant that. Yeah. I didn't become a teacher because I found out that's what my name means. I didn't become a jump out of the boat pioneer or worldwide ministry because I found out that was what my name means. I found out what my name means and look back and say, oh my God, I was doing what my name means. So can I just help you take a shortcut? Just look at yourself. What do you like doing? You see, we immediately think, once we get saved, I got to stop doing what I like doing. Now, I'm not talking about snorting coke or having sex with a neighbor's wife. I mean, if you like doing that, that has to change, all right? Let me clear that up. I'm sorry. You know, there's sometimes, you know, you just, some things you think are a given, but you have to mention it, you know? All right, sin, yeah, we need to change the sin thing. But what I'm saying is you don't change your personality. You don't change what you are created to be and do.
Yeah, right, that's right.
All right, I mean, if you, I like getting high. Well, you do it in worship then.
Yeah.
All right, well, I like love. Well, do it with one person. Okay, so you just... How many say, okay, Bishop cleared that up. Okay, I got that. All right. What do you do without thinking about it? What do you do without having be told to do it? What do you just do? It's just who you are. You can't help but do it. You find yourself doing that. Are we getting there? All right. So rather than trying to find out your name, but I looked up your names and oh my God, it's just, I just went, wow. For sure, for sure, for sure. That is pretty amazing, you know? So all it did to me was confirm, I don't expect any of you to change. And I'm okay with that now. And so what about you? God's got a plan even for you. Romans chapter 12, last portion of scripture. I want you to just right now get your, I don't know. Some of you don't have an actual analog Bible. So I don't know if you can mark in it or not. But we're going to read Romans chapter 12. And if you don't mind marking in it, I want you to circle something that relates to you. We're going to find your gift and calling right here. You don't have to do the personality profile. You don't have to look up your name. All you have to do is find out the end result of what your name did produce in your life. And you should find it in here. Now, I'm going to use King James. Sorry. I grew up in the 50s and 60s. All right. Romans chapter 12. If you have a different translation, I'm just saying that maybe these specific words are not going to appear there. That's all I'm saying. But okay, here we go. Verse 1, I beg of you to present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Don't be conformed to this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God for your life. So what do we see there? Present your bodies. Present your name. Present your calling. Present who you are to the Lord. Just say, here I am. I already know I am a bounce off the wall person, but I'm presenting it to the Lord if he can keep up with me. All right. If you're the absolute boring, committed person, then say, here I am, Lord. I've been in the same place for the last 10 years. But I present myself to you. Amen. Are you okay? All right. And then prove what you're doing is really the perfect will of God. So if it's sleeping around, you'll be able to prove it. Probably not. Okay. If I'm not a tither and a giver and I'm not committed to God, well, then that's not the perfect will of God. If I'm just out there in the world doing the world thing, well, then that's not the will of God, because what's the will of God? He wants to express his glory through your life. So proving the perfect will of God, whose glory am I expressing? All right, here we go. Verse 3, for I say, therefore, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. What's that mean? Well, you're not better than any other gift. I mean, the way you are is not better than the way somebody else is, because God made that other person that way. So you can't, and that's, this is probably aimed at me more than anybody. It's probably aimed at everybody. I mean, the reserved backseat people, they look at leadership and say, who do you think you are trying to run everything? Well, if I didn't run everything, you wouldn't run anything, you know. So it's back and forth, yes? Yeah. But we all need each other is the point here. Why? Because think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Every one of you has been dealt a measure of faith. I've been dealt a measure of faith, not bigger than yours. I have faith to do what I'm called to do, but you've been dealt the measure of faith to do what you've been called to do. For as we have many members in one body, you are not a lone ranger. Stop that mindset. Well, I don't fit. Yes, you do. Someplace in here. There's a pony in here someplace. And all members have not the same office. See, the revelation starts unfold. Okay, we don't have all the same office. So we being many are one body in Christ. We're one body. Everybody say one body. Not two bodies, not four bodies, not 10 bodies, not anybody, somebody, everybody, nobody, one body. This is huge. And every one members one of another. You are needed by another person. That other person needs you. We're all members one of another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. So every one of our gifts is different. Yeah. We doing okay? And here it is. Now I want you to circle one as we go through here. Whether prophecy, which would be inspired preaching or a poet, prophecy. Well, then, I lost my place here, sorry. Let us prophesy according to the proportion of our faith. Or ministry. Ministry. That's a waiter or servant. You love to wait. You love to serve. Let us wait on our serving. Or he that teaches on teaching. Teaching is instruction to help others learn. Teaching. Now again, we're looking at something, you don't have to be told to do this. You can't help but do this. When you walk into a room, you can't help but serve. Because that's what you do. When you walk into the room, you can't help but inspire somebody and preach at them. When you walk into the room, you can't help but start line upon line explaining something to somebody. You catching the flow here? Or he that exhorteth on exhortation. Exhortation is invite or invitation or call. Or he that giveth. Giveth just simply means to share or to deliver. Let him do it with simplicity. He that rules. Rules means stand before, preside, be over, be in charge of. Do it with diligence. He that shows mercy. Everybody say mercy. Elder Christie taught on mercy and gave the definition for mercy. And I thought, mercy, that's a long definition. But you see, mercy to one person is totally different than mercy to another person. Now, if you take an extrovert personality with mercy, it's going to bring out one of those definitions. But you take an introvert that flows in mercy, it's going to bring out another aspect of that. Yeah. Mercy. Do it with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor. That word means hate. God, yes, God has put some people in the body to be haters. I hate everybody. I hate everything. Thank God I got a verse for it. No. It says only hate that which is evil. Okay, so it clarifies it there. It means to detest, hate, move away from relationship. You see, you hate that family member that's always like that. You hate that job that refuses to. You hate this. Are you with me? Somebody has to stand up and say something about that. Yeah. All right? Affectionate. Be kindly affectionate one to another. That means friend, friendly, neighborly. I'm your neighbor. Some people are just neighborly. I'm not really neighborly. Now, my neighbor is neighborly. And I try to go inside when I see him coming over to be neighborly. Was it old Tim Allen show where the neighbor was peeking his head over the thing, you know? I mean, some people like to talk. I don't like to talk about nothing. Did you understand, Nate? I mean, I can't talk about nothing. I mean, let's talk about something for Lord's sakes. You know? You just want to talk. My God. Oh, all right. I've heard this story 14 times every time you catch me before I can get inside. Neighborly. Yeah, and this thing, I'm all things to all men. Oh, stop it. No, you're not. Paul, maybe, not you. All right? You know, so just move on. All right, where am I at? I'm trying to get done with this. Affectionate one to another. Honor. Everybody say honor. That means value others. Some people value others. Some people have no value in others. What's the next one? Business. Everybody say business. Don't be slothful in business. It carries this mean of speed. Wait eagerly an opportunity. About my father's business. Business. Interesting. All right? Hope. Expectation. Confidence. Patience. Patient in tribulation. Stay under. Remain. Persevere. I mean, some people just need to be patient. How many understands that that's, some people are not. All right, but somebody needs to persevere. Somebody needs to stick with the stuff. Yeah. All right, the next one is prayer. Everybody say prayer. And that means supplication. That means intercession. That means worship. You see, some of you, sweet hour of prayer sounds like sweet agony of that much time. Are you with me? So you might better have sweet minute in prayer and be good with it. Yes? But don't be saying sweet hour of prayer when you're looking around and you're looking at your watch and you're watching TV while you're praying. I mean, stop it. This is not you, all right? But for others, 3 hours passed by and I was still praying. Well, good for you, all right? Distributing. Everybody say distributing. That means communicate and share. And then we've got another one, hospitality. Some people are just hospitable. They want people over to their house. Please come over to my house. Please make a mess in my house. Please bring your children and break everything in my house. Please come over. Please track your mud in. I don't care. More mud, the merrier. I mean, more dishes to wash. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hasn't it been a great time? And then other people would say, I don't see that that was a good time at all. Hospitality. Entertain guests, entertainer. Bless them which persecute you. Not everybody has this anointing. Well, bless you. Oh, bless you. Bless you. Oh, stop it. You're being so. But see, some people just can't help but bless somebody. Now, on the other hand, I say, I don't think you ought to bless everybody. I mean, if you got a rebellious kid, that's not a time to bless them. There's one of these other things that you should be doing in this list, you know? All right, rejoice. Somebody say rejoice. Somebody else just, you know, got some money, rejoice with them. I mean, yesterday at the men's meeting, Greg was telling this sob story. He doesn't have insurance money to get him shoes. And then he finally pops the news to us, because I don't have diabetes anymore. Well, the men choked on their omelets. Now, I rejoice with that. Not too many rejoicers in here. Well, God, I wish he'd do something for me. You see, not everybody rejoices. Weep, tears, weep with those who mourn. Look, I'm just glad I'm not going through it. I'm not going to cry with you. But some people just need to cry with someone. Are you with me? We have professional mourners. I'm trying to lighten this up, and then I'm trying to get through it. How many circled one yet? Yes, have you circled one? Can we stop, or someone say, I'm still looking for something here. There's got to be a calling in here somewhere, all right? Provide. Everybody say provide. Provide. Provide things. Some people just like to provide things. Deacon Heath is, you know, a provider. I'll come up with something here. We'll fix this. We'll get this fixed. We'll do something. Resourceful in that. Provide. Look out for others beforehand. That's kind of like a Joseph anointing. I know it's coming, so I want to provide ahead of time. And then live peacefully. See, that one's so hard for me, I don't even know how to pronounce it. Live peaceably with all men. Some people are just peacemakers. You know, come on now, let's just work this out. I'm thinking, go fight it out. It's like Doc Hagen. They came to Doc Hagen one time and said, you know, two deacons are fighting on the church lawn. He said, well, let me know who wins. May the best man win, I don't care. But others are out there trying to make peace and calm this thing down. Are you with me? So if that's you, then we need peacemakers, because God knows there's some fighting going on. So peacemakers. And then we get down to verse 20, therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. Feed. Everybody say feed. Nourish with a crumb or a morsel, a handout. Some people can't help but do that. If there's a need, you're immediately reaching in your pocket. That's just who you are. You can't help but do that. And then drink. If they're thirsty, give them a drink. That means furnish or irrigate. And then the last one is be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. Good is just a moral benefit. How many found something in this list? Now we go back to that scripture. Give diligence to make your calling and election sure. Your name and them calling your name all these years caused you to be one of these things. That is your calling. And you don't have to be an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher to do this stuff. Are you with me? You may be an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher and still do some of this stuff. You may be an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher and not do some of these things. But that doesn't matter. You find out that's the thing. Now that thing, if you do that thing, you'll never fall. Why? Because you're walking and God is walking in you, fulfilling His original plan for the way that He created you. Did you get anything out of this today? Now, if you start doing that, God is going to open an everlasting door for you to come into His kingdom. We sang it today. The kingdom has come. The kingdom has come. What's the kingdom? This is the kingdom. Mercy and hospitality and ruling and giving and serving and waiting. That's the kingdom. People's looking for the kingdom. Well, unless you're born again, you can't even see it. If you're born again, you're going to start looking around and say, well, I see the kingdom. Wow, I see the kingdom. The kingdom is exciting. The kingdom is very precise. The kingdom is go anywhere, talk to anybody, talk to a Muslim, pray with them, cast the devil out of them. The kingdom is stay home, lock the doors, and pray for 14 hours. The kingdom is. The kingdom is as little children running to the altar and bowing down. The kingdom is. How many starting to see the kingdom? All right. Not bad. I'm better than I thought I was. Whew, hallelujah. We're going to worship God. But I want you to present your bodies to the Lord this morning. Maybe you want to present it in the minstrel, and maybe you want to come and present it at the altar here. Just so simply, so non-spiritual, just present yourself to Him.
Okay, here I am. Yes.
Here I am. This is what I do naturally. Yeah. This is what I do without thinking. This is me. But from now on, I want you doing me.
Yes, that's powerful. Yes, sir.
In every day of my life.
Amen.
I open the altar to you. We're going to worship. Maybe I'll come back and pray for some of you, but stay tuned next week for the rest of this story.
Praise God.
But as we present ourselves today, we'll start assembling this next week.
Amen.
We'll start members in particular.
You're right.
We'll start learning how to grow on and grow because of each other's gifts. Amen?
Praise God. Amen.
Again, the altar's open. What are you doing? I'm presenting me.
This is who I am.
Presenting me. I'm not trying to change me. I'm wanting to get God in and through me. Online, just present yourself to Him. Say, thank God, I've been trying to change my life all my life. And realize this is what I'm called to be. I just want to allow God to express Himself through me. Amen and amen. Praise God. Let this word become life in your life right here, right now.